Hello there everyone, welcome back to another video about a children's trading card game, continuing this series of very rapid set reviews so as not to waste any of your time. Let's go ahead and get right into the video. So we are doing Volnar today, and we begin with the legend Magvarius Deinos. This card is obviously very, very strong. Being able to nuke three separate things is powerful, although realistically it's usually going to be one to two things that actually matter. Banishing cards from your opponent's graveyard is fine, and you know, being able to pop enemy, or rather just straight up remove an enemy unit from the field, is really the big one here. The enemy set cards is less likely to matter. It would be nice if this could hit fields as well. On balance, it's pretty good though. A 7-7-3, very nice stat line, good counter, you know, to use it, good OD, good TD. And generally you're going to be using this in Genesis Summon decks and such. Next, we have got Flayer. So this is a very powerful card in Regenleaf and as well in any kind of Genesis Summon list. Why? Because you can put it back. So once you've Genesis Summoned this and your opponent clears it, because of course they're going to, it's only 3 HP and it's 3 strikes, so they're going to want to deal with it, you can immediately, on your next turn, DR1, and just go ahead and slap it right back into deck, easily able to Genesis Summon. Again, this is strictly better than using one of the Volnar cards that will let you shuffle, that will let you put it back on its own, through those cards' abilities, because you don't have to save those cards for this card. You're always going to be able to put this back. So that means this is a very easy 1-2 of inclusion in most decks. Obviously, the danger being if it ends up in damage, but, you know, at 2 copies, it probably won't. It might, but it probably won't. And of course, you know, when a Genesis summons, you get to fucking pop anything. And we know how good that is in dealing with defenders this format. Next, we have got the Deathshade King, Zakatul. This guy is fine. 8 HP is obviously very large. Hits over everything, literally everything in the game. I don't think there's anything bigger. The other advantages, you can bring it back every single turn. Disadvantages, that counter is bad. There are going to be times when you are DR'd out or it's early game, and that is really going to suck if you cannot meet that condition. Sometimes you're just going to get unlucky, and that's going to be the way it is. Additionally, like, 4 HP is not fantastic. It would be nice if it was 5. It would be better if it was 5. But I think on balance, it's a very powerful card. The sort of, you know, the biggest downside is it being a counter and in sort of finding the space for it. It's very archetype restricted. And Darkness doesn't really have the space for it. So as good as this card is, you're realistically going to be playing this in Deathshade, which obviously makes sense. Next, we have got Zayreg. This card is very, very strong. So this is a 6-3-1 that's very generic. You actually don't really care about this being a Deathshade. The fact that you can clear a unit with its 6 attack, you're probably going to, and still deal damage is very, very nice. But on top of that, you literally get to out anything in the game that is putting itself in on your turn. There is not a single card outside of Scoob and Zmai. That's it. Everything else has 6 HP or less, and certainly everything meta-relevant is, you know, generally it's going to be those gear ups, it's going to be those Sentinel summons. This is outing all of them. You get to play this, you get to clear or something, you get to deal some damage. Very, very nice card. Super, super good. Kind of just a better version of Breakthrough for what this card does. Very, very good card. Mega slept on. Sundown Druid, another very powerful card. This one is, it's a little weird. Like, it has potential to be used in Beasts. The problem is, like, I feel like you want to be building Vanquisher Beasts, and this doesn't fit into that. So it's in a bit of an awkward position. It is an Earth, so potentially you want to be going that Earth route to build your Beast deck. That, you know, makes sense. Earth Beasts are very, very powerful, and that probably is the way to go. And I can see that deck being pretty good. But obviously, mainly you're using this in Regenleaf, and this is just a crazy enabler in Regenleaf that lets you pop off, plus go insane. Like, yeah, this is a very, very good card in Regenleaf. Absolutely need to play in the deck. Imol, this is like kind of a necessary evil. Popping an enemy unit level 1 or less is fine. There are more level 1 or less units in the game that are relevant than you might expect. But mainly you're kind of playing this just because it's a level 1 counter, which means it's always going to end up in drop zone, which means you always have a target for Sundown Druid. And that's kind of the big reason you play it. It's like a 2-3 off. Melroar, this is a cool card, but it's one where, like, it doesn't, like, you, it's definitely a build-around card, and there isn't really a deck in existence at the moment that is, like, super good like this. We're getting bits and pieces, we're getting little bits and pieces that could potentially make this very, very strong, or this deck, like, at least work, but at the moment, it's definitely nothing crazy, and for all intents and purposes, I would just be like, why not just build it in Overlord, whatever you're trying to do. So potentially a cool card for later down the line, but at the moment nothing too special. Tsukikage. I slept on this card. I didn't sleep on it. I was overly harsh. Like, at the end of the day, a gear up is a gear up, and this is a gear up. So if you don't have access to other gear ups, you are going to be playing this. And, you know, a 4-4 double attacker, like 14 total damage is actually pretty easy. That's just like the mid game, essentially, when this is going to come online. And having that 8 attack, or that 4 strike, is pretty good. Obviously, the real way this is going to be broken is if you would be able to use it in either Wizard, because then you're getting a huge amount of aggro, or the real one is if you could use this in Dreadnought, which you specifically cannot because it has an Azure River attack ability. You also cannot use this in Trickster, I'm pretty sure. So that's ruling out a bunch of rulers there, which obviously does make like the playability of this card a little bit more sussy. But still, you know, card's nice, and it's a good option to have, and you're probably going to be playing it for basically lack of better options in whatever you're building, because gear up is a powerful mechanic. This is an absolute staple in Dragons, and basically doesn't really get played in anything else. Besides Earth, this is a nice tool for Earth. So yeah, something to have access to. Then we've got Dragon Rider Reconnaissance, so the counter on this is fine. And the main ability is also, like, fine. It's just, I really wish it plussed instead of just, like, giving you an okay wash. Like, it's set four, guys. Martial skill really needs to be getting some actual pluses here. At least if it was, like, you know, draw one, discard, or discard a martial skill, draw three, or some shit. I'd be like, yo, that's crazy. Like, that'd be so good. I don't even know how good it would be, to be honest, because hand advantage... weirdly doesn't matter a massive amount in Gate Ruler, so yeah, I don't know, this is a weird one. It's fine. Next we have got the Goral, the Apostle, 551 on level 2, it's fine. You're going to be slamming this in the center, and you know, if you get some real nice units off of this effect, take 1 damage to special summon like a level 2 and a level 0, or 2 level 1s, is very nice. And there are reasonable odds you're going to be able to get this off. I think I'm just not like a massive fan because it's kind of RNG. You're completely locked off from doing this later on in the game because it's just like not going to be beneficial to you whatsoever. And it weirdly conflicts a little bit with the whole mechanic of DRing because you want to have your options available to you, but obviously you can't special summon something if it's out DR'd, so a bit of a weird one. The card is good in its deck, but I don't really think you'd ever play it. Ever play it outside of a dedicated Deathshade deck. This is, in theory, more generic. DR3 to heal 1 when it deals damage is obviously nice, and your opponent's probably actually not going to be wasting a block on this. So in that sense, when you think about it, it's really DR2 because you are going to be healing 1 of those damage. And, you know, that's fine. I think the card is okay. It's better because it's a level 1, and Deathshade obviously is also struggling to have like a wide variety of level 1s, but I think like it's such an average card that doesn't do anything crazy, that it'll probably get replaced basically as soon as better options really make themselves known. Call for Adventure. This is an absolutely insane card in Genesis Summoning. I don't even think I need to explain why this is so crazy. Like, it's good if you hit it as a counter. It's good if you get it in hand. It's enabling you. Like, it's a phenomenal card. Yeah, very, very, very good. Netherstream Tempest as the, here is DR2 to pop any enemy card in play. This is obviously very good. What's the downside? You need to take Volnar spells, and you are literally never, ever, 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 ever taking Volnar. So whenever Deathshade becomes viable as just a 2 attribute thing, where it's basically whenever black yellow Deathshade becomes viable, which seems like set 5 is really have to do some heavy lifting to make that happen, then this could probably see play. But or obviously if yellow gets, you know, comparable tools to blue, then you might actually feasibly play it over blue. This is a cool card, Return of the King. Basically you're going to be getting those extra levels. Some decks are really going to like this, some decks are really going to hate it. It's really just going to depend on the specific deck, but this is like a nice tool to have. Highlander, very happy. More of these negative level cards are always a good thing to see for Highlander. Next we have got Morva. So this card is fine. 6 HP is basically the kind of one of the biggest selling points of this card. It burns when you actually destroy an enemy unit. Being 3 attack does mean that's a little less likely to happen, but there's enough low HP things in the game where that it will feasibly. But the nice thing is when an ally Deathshade unit pops an enemy unit, you are going to unflip. So all those things together kind of combined make this card pretty decent. But it really is that 6 HP, I think, that sells me on the card being good. But there's so many good level 2s that if you didn't play this in Deathshade, I wouldn't be surprised. Like, it's very like, just about, like, fine. Heady of the Sacred Sword, I truly cannot see a use for this card at the moment. Like, yes, okay, you can get a warrior, but that seems really overcosted for something so restrictive. There's not any particularly great warriors in the game. And like, yes, okay, you can, you know, swap stuff out, but like, you can heal something and then take a damage, but you can never counter that damage, so there's not even that. Yeah, I just don't think this card's very good. It's also got dog shit stats. If it was a level 0, at least, I might be inclined to think a little bit better of it. But they couldn't even give it good stats. Like, it's just not a good card. I know Headyhead. I know Heady's like a meme, but, like, still. This is the one actively just bad gear up in the game. Like, it's strictly worse than ruler stats in most cases. Yes, it's very generic, but, like, I mean, you also have to play yellow, and yellow's barely played at the moment. So, yeah, just a whole host of reasons I don't think this card is very good. This is an absolute staple in any of your Earth-based, your Beast-based decks, your Beast decks, right? Because you're going to want your Forest of Cultivation, which sort of immediately, like, you're sorry, your Forest of Cultivation, your Bloody Forest, you're instantly going to want to have that in there. So, yeah, this is a staple four of in those decks. This is a 622 vanilla. Cool, it's set four, we don't care. Here's a kind of vanilla card we might actually care about, though. This is a level 1, 5, 4, 3, so massive stats. These are level 2 level vanilla stats here, right? And you only have to DR 1 a turn for it to be, you know, active. This card is obviously very, very strong in a specific Dark Knight build, because you can play the level 2 to, was it Godin, to summon this guy out, and Godin is going to be able to clear the defensive unit, whatever it may be, thanks to that instant kill effect, ensuring you're going to be going face with this 3 strike from this guy. So I think this is a powerful card, definitely going to see play in a Dark Knight deck as and when that gets any better. At the moment it's a little bit whatever, but you know, in the future. Bad card. So, like, you have to set it. Except you don't. You can also play it from hand, so I don't really know why the timing was there. But you have to be geared up. And then you get to stack your opponent's deck, and then burn one. So, like, I don't know. Like, how good is this? I don't know. Like, you know, you so stacking the deck is obviously good if your opponent has, like, a load of counters. That's obviously very, very nice. If your opponent doesn't have a load of counters, then this is actively bad, because it doesn't give... if this gave you the choice, I think it would be so much better. Yeah, I don't know. It's fine. It's just, again, you have to be playing Volnar, and Volnar also has, like, the worst gear up option, so, like, it's fine. Like, I think, I definitely think a martial skill warrior deck will eventually be good. Eventually be good, right? Because, like, obviously, if you could loop a shit ton of these in a turn, that could be very, very powerful, because this is, again, a martial skill. We'll see. The potential is here. It's getting the tools. It's just, it needs more. It really needs more, and this is not what's going to push it over the edge. But this is pretty good in terms of having that huge potential. This is another card that's, like, fine. This one isn't a martial skill. You can play it from your hand to burn one if your opponent has... At the end of an attack phase, you can play it to burn one to your opponent if you have 2 life or less, or you can banish your willpowers to make it burn 2. There's more willpowers in the game than you might expect, but, like, you know, are you really dedicating, like, space to this to, like, make this happen? I don't know. It seems fine. If you stack, like, 3 of them up in hand, it's probably going to secure a kill. And it's at the end of an attack phase, so you can do it at the end of yours. But, yeah, I don't know. I'm just not a big fan of this card. Garbage card. And garbage card. So, there we go. That is it for Volnar. I hope you guys found this video useful. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section down below. Have I massively over or underrated some cards? Let me know. Join my Discord server and subscribe to the channel for more Gate Ruler content. More of these set reviews coming soon. So I'll see you guys in the next one. Cheers.